me up.
Good morning. Welcome. Glad to have everyone for another beautiful Sunday morning here in the North Georgia Mountains. It's kind of cold and feels like wintertime again, even though spring is right around the corner. For everybody that remembered to move your clocks forward, we want to say, you're smart. You people are sharp. We want to thank you for doing that, and especially if you're joining us with us via the internet, we want to welcome you here. We're always blessed with your presence over the internet because we don't know where you are, and it's always great to find out later, you know, how many people are watching. We have people from Florida, Arizona, Alaska, Wisconsin, you know, all around, at Georgia, South Carolina. A lot of my old friends from South Carolina tune in and watch a bunch of South Kakalaki people. And so I'm always always blessed to have them join us. Jan and I, along with Jim and Sandra, we try to do this on a regular basis, weather permitting. I think we have done one from our living room, which was a real treat. had our pit bull, Bella, she was running around trying to get in the chair, and then the fire went out.
We enjoyed it.
It was entertaining.
Yeah, entertaining if nothing else. Got a couple of old hymns today that we're gonna sing. Got a little different type of message I want to share with you today, and let's sing a little bit. This is an old, real old Southern Baptist type song that I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned unclean. Oh, how marvelous, oh, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. Oh, how marvelous, oh, how wonderful is my Savior's love. Sins and my sorrow, he made them his very own. He bore the burden of Calvary and suffered and died alone. Oh, how marvelous, oh, how wonderful is my God shall ever be. Oh, how marvelous, I last shall see will be my joy through the ages to sing his love for me. Oh, how marvelous, oh, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. Oh, how marvelous, oh, how wonderful is my the chorus again, everybody. Oh, how marvelous, oh, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. Oh, how marvelous, oh, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me.
Give the Lord a praise. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my pardon, this my plea. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. But the blood of Jesus. This is all my hope and peace. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. This is all my righteousness. Nothing but the blood. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Give the Lord a praise. Let's pray together. Father, we do stand amazed in your presence. Every time we gather together, God, to give you praise and to give you honor, we remember, we reflect on who we are in you. And I pray today as we talk about one of the most interesting stories in Scripture, how it pertains to us as believers. I pray as always, Father, that you would open up the eyes of our hearts and that you would let us see your word in a very real, very personal, very relevant way. We love you, Lord. We thank you so much for loving us. We ask your blessings today, Father, in the name of your Son, Jesus. And all God's children said,
Amen.
Amen. Before we get started today, I want to do a little song that I wrote. And may give you an idea of kind of the direction of where we're going a little bit anyway, or the reference to the scripture. And so I want you to just take a listen. This is a song called You Must Be Born Again. And I wrote it about the character that we're going to be looking at today. And it goes something like this.
Of the Jews. In the middle of the night, he slipped out to meet Jesus. He said, I have some questions for you. I've listened closely to the things that you've been saying, things I don't quite understand. There remains just one point of contention. You say I must be born again. I must be born again. Jesus smiled as he talked with Nicodemus. He knew old Nick, he was confused. He said, brother, I'm not trying to be facetious. Just want to share the truth with you. You never wonder about the wind or where it's blowing. So try your best to understand. There's only one way that you'll ever see God's kingdom. You must be born again. Yes, you must be born again. You must be born of the Spirit, washed by the blood, redeemed in glory by heaven's perfect love. Jesus said, if I be lifted up, I will draw men. If you want to get to heaven, you must be born again. If you want to get to heaven, you must be born again. Years have passed since the time of Nicodemus. The good news still has a chance. Too many people all asking the same question. The answer's still the same. Nothing in this world could ever get you into glory. Jesus gave us his best plan. There's only one way that you'll ever see God's kingdom. You must be born again. Yeah, you must be born again. You must be born of the Spirit, washed by the blood, redeemed in glory by heaven's perfect love. Jesus said, if I be lifted up, I will draw men. If you want to get to heaven, you must be born again. If you want to get to heaven, you must be born again. You must be born of the Spirit, washed by the blood, redeemed in glory by heaven's perfect love. Jesus said, if I be lifted up, I will draw all men. If you want to get to heaven, you must be born again. If you want to get to heaven, you must be born again.
Thank you. Well, today the title of the message is I'm a Believer. And last week, in a haste to get started with the message and explain what Lent was all about, for those who don't celebrate Lent or experience Lent every year, I failed to let you in on the name of the series that I wanted to do this during the season of Lent, and actually all the way up until our Easter sunrise morning service, which, by the way, that will be our only service that day. So I want to encourage you to go to bed early, get up early, get here early, and then we'll get out of here early. That way you can spend the day, spend Easter with your family and friends. And it's always, last year, I think we had the most people. I think we had almost like 80 plus people here for our Easter sunrise service. And so it's always a lot of fun to do that. That's how this whole thing of Jesus and Jeans got started. And this will be our third year of being involved in it. And Bobby and Dawn, we have communion, and they are so precious. Dawn bakes bread and brings it, and Bobby just shares his heart during the communion service, and it's just a real special time. But the series that I want to teach up until that point is called The Pathway to the Cross. And I want us to spend time looking at some of the things that Jesus did. Things that were important to him during his ministry. Last week we focused on the beginning of Jesus' ministry as told in the book of Luke, chapter 4. And we looked at verses 1 through 13. And this week I want you to look at Luke chapter 4. But that's not where we're going to end up. But I want you to look at Luke chapter 4. Hello. Matthew, Mark.
What happened, Grace?
Right.
Right
after Hezekiah.
Yeah, right after Hezekiah.
Oh, that was good.
Good one. I love that guy. And I don't know how it is in your Bible, but in my Bible, the last verse, verse 13 says, "And when the devil had finished all this tempting, he left him until an opportune time." And right between verse 13 in my Bible and verse 14, where it says Jesus returned to Galilee, you see that verse in verse 14? There's a little space between those two. And that's what we're going to focus on today, is that little space between verse 13 and 14. You see, Christ's earthly ministry was only 3.5 years long, but Luke takes 30% of that and says absolutely nothing about it. Christ's first year of ministry is relegated to, if you're reading Luke, yes, Lord. Somebody's calling us from Houston, Texas, man.
You got a free trip coming.
I hope they're watching. We know that. But Christ's earthly ministry is relegated to this little space, if you're reading the book of Luke, to this little space between verse 13 and 14. And some of you may be thinking, oh, come on. You know, what could possibly be there in that space? Well, you know what's in that little space? A whole year of Christ's ministry. A whole year. Luke takes the whole first year of Christ's ministry and boils it down to a space, a gap, a little small opening between one sentence and another. How do we know this is the case? And this is one of the things that you need to know when you're reading the scriptures, because you got to be able to put it all together, you know, and read it. We know it by comparing Luke with the other gospel accounts. So when this is done, when Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John are all compared with one another, it's discovered that only John says anything at all about Christ's first year of ministry. And all three of the others, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, when they begin to talk about the ministry of Christ, they jump right into the second year of his ministry. Only John tells us about Christ's first year of ministry. And so I want to talk just for a few minutes about why John includes the events of Christ's first year, but Matthew, Mark, and Luke do not. And to understand it, we got to understand the purpose of Christ's first year. And this is so important. The overriding purpose of Christ's first year of ministry was to make believers. That was the whole purpose. That was the overriding purpose of his ministry, was to make believers. This is why he did what he did that first year. This is why that he went where he went. And as he went about from place to place, John tells us that Jesus was constantly telling people that in order to have eternal life, all they had to do was to believe in him for it. In fact, the word believe is found 22 times in the first four chapters of John. Over and over and over again, Jesus does something and people believe in him. Jesus teaches something and more people believe in him. The overriding purpose of Christ's first year of ministry was to make believers out of the Jews and out of Samaritans. Those were the people in his sphere of influence, were the Jews and the Samaritans. In the first year, he gains hundreds, if not thousands, of believers. So let me explain first what happened in Christ's first year. First of all, somewhere after the time of temptation, Jesus has gained a few followers and he decides to go to Galilee. That's in John chapter 1. So they went there and they attend a wedding feast. And it's a story that many of us are familiar with. It's a story where Jesus performed his very first miracle. And that was changing the water into wine. Can I get an amen? Yeah. After this, Jesus headed back down to Jerusalem for the Passover. That's in John chapter 2. When he got there, he found the temple was full of merchants and money changers. And so he intentionally, and I want you to grab this, he intentionally made a whip out of cords. Just sat there making this whip. Wasn't angry, wasn't vengeful. Just made the whip, went in the temple and cleansed the temple. He drove everybody out. And he said, my Father's house will be a house of prayer. It'll be a house of worship. It's not going to be a place where you sell turtle doves to poor people because they have no offering to give to the Lord. And so he drove them out because of their motives. Their motivation was wrong. And so his actions and his teachings sparked a lot of controversy among the Pharisees. These were the religious leaders of the day. And one of them, named Nicodemus, came to Jesus by night to question him about eternal life. And that's where we're going to start in the book of John. So if you will, turn over to the book of John. And we're going to read these stories. All right. And as you're turning there, let me share with you. The story of Nicodemus is what we're going to focus on. But because today's title of the message is called I'm a Believer. And yes, as a baby boomer, I borrowed the title from the Monkey Song by the same name. Now, as soon as I said that, how many of you immediately remembered that song and started singing the song?
Yeah.
You know, a lot of people don't realize that Neil Diamond actually wrote I'm a Believer, which is a little music trivia there for you before we get into the word. But that's what he did. Now, I digress. Let's go to John chapter 4. And let me read these scriptures for you. Turn on the lamp. Can you turn on that lamp? Mm-hmm. Someone.
Anyone.
My eyes are getting weak.
You're how old?
I am 65. So we're in verse chapter 3. We're going to begin with verse 1. Now there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a member of the Jewish ruling council. He came to Jesus at night and said, Rabbi, we know you are a teacher who has come from God, For no one could perform the miraculous signs you were doing if God were not with him. In reply, Jesus declared, I tell you the truth. No one can see the kingdom of God unless he is born again. How can a man be born when he's old? Nicodemus asked. Surely he cannot enter a second time into his mother's womb to be born. Jesus answered, I tell you the truth. No one can enter the kingdom of God unless he is born of water and the Spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to spirit. You should not be surprised at my saying, you must be born again. The wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sounds, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it is going. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit. How can this be? Nicodemus asked. You are Israel's teacher, said Jesus, and do you not understand these things? I tell you the truth. We speak of what we know, and we testify to what we have seen. But still, you people do not accept our testimony. I have spoken to you of earthly things, and you do not believe. How then will you believe if I speak of heavenly things? No one has ever gone into heaven except the one who came from heaven, the Son of Man. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the desert, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. He goes on to say, this is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but men love darkness instead of light because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear his deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light, so that it may be seen plainly that what he has done has been done through God. Very powerful scriptures. This is a great story of Jesus sharing, witnessing to a religious leader, a guy who was already supposed to know the Torah, you know, the Jewish Bible. He was supposed to already know, and here is this guy who has heard the teachings of Jesus, and he has some questions that he needs asked. And he comes to Jesus and has this conversation. There was a man that was sitting on a park bench, and his friend came to the park and he sees him there. And the first man began to tell his friend, he says, you know, I've had something wonderful happen in my life. So his friend says, really? What's so wonderful? What, you know, what's happened to you? He said, I just got a hearing aid that has improved my ability to hear. And his friend says, well, really? What kind is it? The first guy looks at his watch and says, well, it's about 3 o'clock. Ha, 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 ha. You know, sometimes you and I are like that. You see, Nicodemus was definitely like that when Jesus was talking to him. He was talking to him about being born again, and he heard what Jesus was saying, but he was having trouble understanding. Nicodemus knew that there was something special about Jesus. Nicodemus was talking about what he knew and also revealing something about what he wanted to know. And Jesus knew that Nicodemus was spiritually hungry. That's why Jesus was telling him, "I tell you the truth. No one can see the kingdom of heaven unless he is born again." And so on this second Sunday of Lent, I want to share with you four steps to take in helping others become a believer. If there's anything that we can do during the Lenten season, it's to share the love of Christ with others with the intention of leading them to Christ. There's an old idea. There was actually a book written that during Lent, one of the things that we should do is random acts of kindness. It's a great book if you've never read that book. There's a whole list of things that you can do to connect with people. You know, like somebody moving into your neighborhood and you don't know those people and they're over there unloading boxes and trying to get everything in the house. You know, they don't have time to cook a meal. Show up with a pizza and a salad and some drinks and say, "Hey, my name's Teddy. Welcome to the neighborhood. Can we be friends?" You know, and you connect with them by offering an act of kindness, a random act of kindness. But I want to take it just a little further. And instead of just doing random acts of kindness, I want to challenge all of us here to do intentional acts of kindness. And the greatest of these intentional acts, in my opinion, is to share the faith that you have in Jesus and use words if you have to. But this really is a particular time where you do use words because you have to engage with people on some level. And certainly we want people to see Jesus in us. But once they see Jesus in us, we want to be able to share with them and we want to be able to talk with them and helping them understand what we have as believers. There may be people that live around you. There may be family members. There may be friends. You know, and you, again, you don't want to do like I did when I first became a believer, because I had a big King James Bible about that thick. You know, that was a workout, man, just carrying that thing around. And I'd hit you over the head with it. You know, you'd have Holy Bible imprinted right across your forehead. Because I was so passionate about telling every single person that I came in contact with about Jesus, about my faith in Jesus. And I realized that I ended up driving more people off than I did winning them to Christ. Now, there were a few people that just said, "Okay, let me up, you know, yeah." So what are you selling? I mean, you know. And then I finally, you know, discovered a new way of engaging with people one-on-one. And so I want us to look at four steps that I believe will help you as believers share with other people. The first one is, like Nicodemus, always build on their curiosity. Always build on their curiosity. Find out where they are on their spiritual journey. I often ask questions like, "Well, how much do you know about the Bible? What do you know about Jesus? Tell me how much you know." That's a great starting point. Doesn't mean that you have to be a Bible scholar. It just gives you an idea of where they are. And a lot of times people in sharing with you their concept of God and Jesus and all that kind of stuff, gives you an idea of what type of experience they've had in life. Maybe they haven't been exposed to God at all. Maybe they grew up in a totally different denomination or setting or understanding or teaching of Jesus. You know, maybe I met a lot of people that have been abused and hurt by the church. When I led a recovery ministry, that's what I saw more than anything else. Because there's so many churches out there that like to clean their fish before they catch them. And so, you know, their idea is, well, if you clean up and get your act together and, you know, dress like us, be like us, talk like us, you can be part of the club. And we'll be just glad to have you. And we'll take your money. We'll put you in the ministry. We'll burn you out. And you will hate God at some point. And I've seen that happen over and over and over again. And so it's finding out where they are. Asking questions. Just probing questions to find out what type of experience they had. And then when they ask questions, then answer their questions by speaking the truth with love and add a lot of grace to it. I make it a point to tell people, and I tell you all the time, I'm not the role model. I know that I'm not perfect. And I know that I continually mess things up. That I continually to struggle with my flesh. You know, and I'm like the guy, you know, that you know the story I've told you several times. Lord, this morning I have not said one curse word. I have not sinned against you. I have not done anything, Lord, that I have not taken your name in vain. I have not criticized anyone. I have not been judgmental of anyone. But in just a few minutes, I'm going to get out of bed. That's me. And I want to be as transparent about that as I possibly can. Because I want people to know that if you come to Jesus, it's not the easiest thing that you're going to ever do. You know, bells and whistles are not going to go off. It's not like winning the lottery. Lights are flashing. God, some guy comes out with a big check and says, "You're saved!" Not going to happen. It's going to be this steady growing and maturing, just like a baby that takes baby steps and grows and matures into the faith in Christ. You see, Nicodemus was curious as to the connection that Jesus had with God. He said, obviously, we can see that God is with you. I mean, who could do the things that you're doing if God wasn't there? Had to be somebody else. We know who that is. So he thought it was a special connection. It was as if Nicodemus was asking, "Hey, Jesus, what's your secret? Nobody can do these things unless God was with you. And if you were to ask a magician the secrets of his magic tricks, you think he's going to go, "Oh, no problem. Come right over here. I'll show you how I do that." Not. You know, he's not going to share the tricks of the solutions, the way he does the tricks, performs his tricks. He's not going to do that. Thankfully, Jesus is not a magician. He is the one and only begotten Son of God. And Jesus explains his connection with God as God's only begotten Son. And he explains to Nicodemus what we have to do to have God in our lives, which comes through belief and faith in Jesus. And Jesus explains this idea by telling Nicodemus that in order to enter God's kingdom, one must be born again. Born from above. Jesus is talking about being made anew in God's life-giving spirit. A lot of my brothers who come from what I call the capital F, you know, fundamental teachings, of the Bibles makes being born again sound like a bad word.
Well, you've got to be born again. Turn or burn. That's your option.
Well, thank you for sharing. The reality is, that's the truth. It's just said in such an offensive way that I don't want to have lunch with you. You get on my nerves. You wear me out. You may have the best thing going, but I don't want any. I've said that. Another thing that explains Nicodemus' curiosity was how he came to Jesus. He came to Jesus at night. There are various opinions as to why Nicodemus came to Jesus at night. Some say that Nicodemus came to Jesus at night because he wanted to have a one-on-one conversation with Jesus. If he came to him in the daytime, there were all these people that gathered around him because he was healing people and he was teaching people. And all these people were gathered around him. All the disciples were always around him. And so they believe that Nicodemus came to him to say, Lord, man, I want to talk to you just one-on-one. There are other beliefs that Nicodemus came in the middle of the night because he was shy about being seen talking to Jesus.
I mean, he was a Pharisee. He was a religious leader.
And so he didn't want his reputation to be stained a little bit because he came to talk to Jesus about eternal life. And then the last one is that it's like a symbolic thing that Nicodemus came to see Jesus, and it was symbolic of the fact that he was living in darkness, meaning that he was ignorant of God's light that shines in the darkness through Christ. Now, that's a little weird for me, so I don't buy into that one. I do buy into the second one. I believe that he came to Jesus because he didn't really want his reputation to be questioned about talking to Jesus. And we have to realize that a lot of people that we come in contact with, that we engage with, are just like Nicodemus. They have a curiosity. They have questions. They have things that they want to know. They are what we call spiritual seekers. And they are so close. They just want their questions answered. They want their curiosity to be satisfied. Does that make sense? So, like Nicodemus, build on that curiosity. You know, dangle a little bait out there. If you're going to catch a fish, you got to put a lure in the water. You know, you got to dangle something out there to make them. And what we dangle is our life. That there's something different about how we're living, and that as we engage with people, they see that, they have questions about that, and we have that opportunity to build on their curiosity. The second thing is, like Nicodemus, feed their hunger. It's obvious that Nicodemus was a man who was spiritually hungry. Nicodemus, after all, was a religious man. All of the Pharisees were religious people. And they let you know it. Yet the religion that he had wasn't satisfying his soul. It wasn't satisfying him. God made us in such a way that we will not find rest until we find it in him. St. Augustine once said, we will never find rest for our souls until we find rest in him. And that is such a true and powerful statement. That's the way my life in coming to Jesus, like I said, this time of year is just so special to me because it's when I came to Christ. And I tried filling that void in my heart, in my soul, my spirit, with everything that I possibly could. You know, I tried in the music business, you know, I tried every way I could be to be a rock star. I wanted to be like Elvis. I wanted to be like the Beatles. I wanted to be like whoever was out there at that time. And I thought, well, if I can get to that place, then I'll be happy. I'll have all the money I want. I can do anything I want. I'll buy my mother a car. I'll buy her a house. I'll buy all my brothers something cool. And I'll be a great guy. Because I have it all. How's that working for you? Almost killed me. Because it took me into other things that I tried to replace that void with. Drugs, alcohol, relationships. All those things that when I first became a believer, I struggled with. That's what I was talking about last week. Jan thought I might have not have played. Actually, how should I say it? Completely explained my lust issues.
Amen.
Amen. See, I came out of the rock and roll industry. It was sex, drugs, and rock and roll. And that's all I knew. I started traveling on the road playing music when I was 9 years old. I was exposed to a lot. And I was thrust into this world, adult world, that I didn't have a clue about. And so a lot happened to me. I experienced a lot. And I just had sort of a weird way of looking at the world and looking at people. You know, when you look at people like Michael Jackson and, you know, like the Osmonds and other artists who have come into the world, you know, if you compare like Michael Jackson to Donny Osmond, you know, he had his faith. He was very grounded in the Mormon faith. I don't care what you think about Mormons, but it protected him. You know, his faith protected him. And he grew up, you know, probably had his moments. But he wasn't like Michael Jackson, who was abused and just taken all kind of weird places. See, I was more like Michael.
Easy.
I was a nut. You know, I was screwed up as a box of coat hangers, man. I mean, you couldn't, you know, trying to unravel all that stuff was a serious undertaking. And thank God for the Holy Spirit who began to do that, you know. But it was only until I allowed that void to be filled with the Holy Spirit and was willing to change and willing to accept the discipline and the things that God wanted to change me from the inside out. And that's what happened. You see, Jesus reminds Nicodemus that he was a teacher. And then he causes him to question his teaching ability. Jesus was pointing out that Nicodemus taught as if he was a blind man leading the blind. And Jesus was telling him between the lines that he needed faith. When we have faith, we also have a feeling of assurance. A little boy attended a certain Sunday school and church, and his mother was not a Christian. She had a horror of death and would not go to church for fear that she would hear something about dying. And on Easter Sunday, the little boy came running home with a message for her. And he came joyfully into the room and he cried out, "Mother, you need not be afraid to die. Jesus went through the grave and he left a light behind." She came to church with him and learned the great lesson and soon became a believer. She became a happy Christian. Being a Christian means that we'll only have to die one time. That's what the Bible says. It's appointed unto man to die once and then the judgment. Was it possible that maybe Nicodemus was scared of dying himself? The whole conversation was about death and the life beyond. And Jesus told Nicodemus that what is born of the flesh will die. And he also said that those who are born of the water and the Spirit will be able to enter into the kingdom of God. And so Jesus fed his hunger. He was spiritually hungry. He was searching for answers, even being a religious leader. And Jesus fed that hunger that he had. That's what we should do with people that we engage. The third step is, like Nicodemus, help with their struggle. You know what the constant struggle that I see even in believers today is? The quest for assurance. I've seen believers that have been Christians for many, many years. And when asked, are you going to heaven when you die? You know what their answer is? Well, I hope so. You hope so? Well, what do you believe? And let me give you some scriptures to back that up. 2 Timothy 1:12. Paul is writing, and he says it this. He says, I know whom I have believed, and I'm convinced that he's able to guard what I've entrusted in him until that day. Paul says, I know whom I have believed. I'm convinced that he's able to carry me through everything I've entrusted to him, my faith in him, my love for him, my assurance of salvation. I am convinced. That's a big deal. John 20, 30 and 31 from the Message translation, it says this: Jesus provided far more God-revealing signs than are written down in this book, in the book of John. And when you read the book of John, it's the whole story of Jesus. These are written down so you will believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God. And in the act of believing, you will have real and eternal life in the way he personally revealed it. See, those are not things that you have to, well, I hope so. Those are facts. 1 John, the last one, 1 John 5:13 says, these things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life, and that you may believe on the name of the Son of God. Those are scriptures that you can take to the bank about your salvation. You see, I hope so is a relative term. I hope the Falcons don't blow it again this year. I hope the Braves enjoy their new stadium and win the pennant. I hope a lot of things, but I don't hope so one day that I'm going to go to heaven. I know where I'm going to spend eternity. Now, I may be back on the back 40. And I may not have a lot of rewards when I get there. But baby, my ticket is punched. Amen. And I'm going to be on the bus. They're not going to be waiting on me. I'm not going to be worried about, you know, where should I go? I know that I know that I know. And as believers, you have to get that settled in your heart. Because that's what's contagious. That's what people want to hear. That it's real. It's not a fairy tale. It's not a bunch of stories written down by a bunch of guys. It's God-inspired, God-promised, God-given. His very best that he had. And that's what people want to know. You see, Nicodemus, a lot of people have head knowledge. All the head knowledge in the world is not going to get you there. That's why he lacked assurance. Assurance means confidence and trust and security. Nicodemus was very knowledgeable because of his position as a Pharisee. He knew a lot about the Torah. He knew a lot about what they taught. He knew a lot about the rules. He knew a lot about religion. But he didn't know Jesus. He didn't know that salvation does not come from what we know. It comes from who we know. It comes from who we have believed in. Knowing Jesus and having a personal relationship, a one-on-one relationship with Christ. There was a story of a young lady who was a bright student, and unfortunately, she didn't have assurance, and her name was Marion, and she was working her way through college by cleaning the dorm rooms of her fellow students, and she was often annoyed by their inability to say thank you or please. And one day she got so disgusted and disillusioned that she was ready to quit. So she went to see her professor. And at the time, she was full of anxiety and anger. And she said, I've been talking, you know, taking all of these courses in philosophy and learning all these things to talk about what's true, what's important, what's good. Well, how do you teach people to be good? Well, the answer to that question, according to the Bible, is not education. It's conversion. It's not education, it's transformation that makes the difference. And we're called to help with that transformation. The light of true goodness dawns in the heart only when God shines there. And unless we have the light that Jesus gives, we're living in the dark. And so it was this, Jesus was saying to Nicodemus, you don't get it, Nicodemus. You're not getting it. I've been sitting here talking about a lot of the earthly things. How are you going to understand the spiritual? You're the teacher. You're the one that's supposed to be teaching everybody. But you don't get it. You've got to be born of the Spirit. And that only happens when you get out of the way and you allow God access to that place, that inner being. Always remember, I tell you I tell you frequently, remember what ego stands for. Edging God out. And so if your ego is more important, or the person you're sharing with, if their ego is more important than anything that you're going to tell them, you got to realize, yeah, maybe he's not going to get it. Maybe she's not going to get it right now. And you know what? That's okay. What our job is to shine the light. Is to be the salt. To be light. There is not one thing in the world that can satisfy our hunger for God except God and his love. And then the last thing to do is to just introduce them to Jesus and lead them in a prayer of faith. What is it that gives the assurance that Nicodemus was looking for? The answer is faith. We are saved by faith, Ephesians 2:8. We're justified by faith, Romans 5:1. We must walk by faith and not by sight, 2 Corinthians 5:7. We must pray by faith, Matthew 21:22. We must resist evil by faith, Ephesians 6:16. We must grow from faith to faith, Romans 1:17. For anything that is not faith is sinful. Therefore, it's the prayer of faith. God, I don't have it all together. I don't understand all that I know about you. But as much as I possibly can, right now, I do A, B, C. I accept you for who you are as the Son of God. I believe that you are who you say you are. and I confess my sin to you. Come into my heart. Change me from the inside out. Jesus is still the answer. Why is he the answer? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him will not perish, but shall have everlasting life. Who cannot love a God like that? I told you before, I wouldn't do it. I'm too self-centered. I'm too selfish. I'm too full of me. Jesus did it. And if he did it, we can do it. Don't be afraid of your faith. Don't be scared to share. Don't let the ways of this world drive you into silence. Be bold. Be courageous. We know where we're going. We've read the end of the book. And we know that we are more than conquerors because of Christ in us. Let's pray together. Father, we pray this season of Lent, God, that as other people are giving up things, help us to buy in to doing intentional things. And the greatest thing, Lord, is to help us share our faith. Lord, help us to take these four steps, building on curiosity, feeding hunger. Lord, helping people with their struggles, and then leading them in a prayer of faith. God, help us to be those kinds of people who are not afraid to share what we have in you. And when it's time to use the words, let us do it with boldness, Father. We love you, Lord, and we know beyond a shadow of a doubt that you love us. Go with us, Father. Open the doors. Make a way where there is no way. Help us to engage with those around us that brings honor and glory to you. We love you, Lord. Thank you so much for loving us. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. And all God's children said,
Amen.
Amen. Thank you guys for coming. God bless you.